Echo and Harper Audio present Pests, How Humans Create Animal Villains by Bethany Brookshire. Read by Courtney Patterson. A note before we begin. For additional reading materials, notes on the text, and more, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider, or go directly to harpercollins.com/pages/pests. To Vince, who is my home. Introduction. A pest is... Consider the squirrel. Many people love squirrels. People cheer for them and smile as their compact, fluffy bodies race over trees and power lines. Every college campus is convinced their squirrels are bolder than any others. I've got a friend who posts a squirrel picture to Twitter every single day, without fail. Squirrels are symbols of fluffy, chipper, charming wildlife come to grace our suburban and urban lives. Then there's me. Me and effing Kevin. Effing Kevin is an eastern gray squirrel, Sciurus carolinensis. We call him Kevin for short. He lives in a graceful maple in front of my house. He's a fine, chubby figure of a squirrel. His especially busy tail flicks forward over his back as he trots confidently around my property. Kevin is my mortal enemy. This squirrel is the reason I haven't had a tomato from my struggling little garden for at least 5 years. I'm a poor gardener at best, but every time the weather warms, optimism kicks in and I try again. In years past, I would line big pots up on the back porch and plant seedlings with desperate hope. I've tried most of the usual suspects, basil, zucchini, peppers, but there's a special place in my heart for tomatoes. I have memories from childhood of standing in the middle of my mom's tiny, somewhat dry garden plot in the heat of late July, sneaking cherry tomatoes off the vine and popping them in my mouth. They burst joyfully on my tongue. They were sun-warmed and intensely flavorful, the best health food I'd ever tasted. Every spring, I set out to recapture that perfect experience. I sally forth with hope and plant my tomato seedlings. Every summer, I am doomed to fail because of effing Kevin. There's definitely more than one of him, to be fair. Kevin's probably the godfather of a squirrel mafia. Maybe he's like Batman with different squirrels donning the mask at different times. To me, though, they're all Kevin. He owns my yard. He chitters bossily at me from his tree and makes little threatening rushes at me on the sidewalk. But his biggest crimes occur when my precious tomatoes emerge. They swell up, hopeful and green. Every year I look at them and cross my fingers. Just a few more sunny days, and those lovely little beauties will be mine. I start planning menus of caprese salad, ratatouille, and salsa. And every year, Kevin strikes. He selects a nice, plump, green tomato and takes a big bite. Suddenly, Kevin recalls that he does not, in fact, like tomatoes. He leaves the perfect green sphere with its tragic tooth marks to rot, making sure to leave it right where I can see it. Then, he does it again, and again. It's an aggressive show of constant optimism. Every evening, it seems, Kevin tries out a new tomato, then remembers that tomatoes suck. He leaves his victims for me to find as a clear sign of his superiority. For 5 years running, Kevin has taken a bite out of every single tomato in my garden and stuck me with store-bought salsa. I've tried a lot of things to get rid of Kevin. I put chicken wire around my plants, but squirrel paws and cherry tomatoes are smaller than typical chicken wire holes. I sprayed the growing tomatoes with a cayenne pepper solution to burn his little mouth. He waited, then chowed down after a late summer rainstorm washed it away. I started feeding feral cats on the back porch, thinking a predator or three would keep him at bay, The cats became tame. Two came inside and became our new pets. Kevin added cat food to his diet. One year, I tried the nuclear option. I planted no tomatoes. Instead, I filled pots and cups with jalapeno pepper seeds, hoping Kevin would fall for my devious trick. I fantasized about his squeak of spiced dismay. I pictured a speedy squirrel retreat and the tears running down his furry cheeks. Squirrels can't weep, but I can dream. He never even tasted one. Neither did I. It turns out I'm such a bad gardener, I can't even keep a jalapeno pepper alive. Many of my friends have heard the story of effing Kevin. Neighbors know about him. We now call every squirrel in the neighborhood by his name. Most people think it's a silly story of my own incompetence and a squirrel's resourcefulness. It's also the story of a pest. To other people, Kevin is a simple squirrel, perhaps a little smarter than your average rodent. He's cute, fluffy, possibly even sweet. To me, Kevin is a constant headache. He makes me feel powerless and foolish. What kind of sciencey person, what kind of adult must I be that I can't keep a squirrel away from my tomatoes? Every dead green orb seems to judge me, a silly suburbanite who can't keep a garden alive. And it's all because of effing Kevin. I have looked up the average lifespan of an adult squirrel. 6 years, give or take two or three, and every year I cross my fingers that this is his last. Maybe this spring he'll come down with mange. Maybe he'll eat himself to death on my tomatoes. Or maybe I'll break and buy a BB gun. Kevin is evidence of my inability to control my environment. When we are observing squirrels through the safety of our camera lens, when we have nothing they want, they are adorable wildlife. When they have the temerity to nest in our chimneys, move into our attics without paying rent, or use our gardens as an all-you-can-eat buffet, it's another story. Squirrel intrusions into our lives are also indicators of animal success. Species of squirrel hang out on every continent except Antarctica. A group of squirrels, by the way, is called a scurry or a dray. From an original diet of nuts and seeds, they've expanded to French fries and bacon. They're one of the few mammals on the planet that can go down a vertical surface head first. Most are scatter hoarders, burying caches of food for the lean times in winter. They have highly accurate spatial memories and can pinpoint exactly where they left precious nuts months after hiding them. I have to have someone call my phone at least once a week because I can't remember where I left it. I admit it. I'm impressed. Urban charmer or suburban menace? Squirrels are both. Their status doesn't depend on their behavior. They're just trying to live their best squirrel lives. Instead, whether a squirrel is cute or a curse depends on how we see them. In some places, such as in Scotland, squirrels have gone from persecuted pest to a source of national pride. There, the red squirrel, Sciurus vulgaris, is native to the woods and glens. The scientific name might be vulgaris, meaning common, but it doesn't look it. The red squirrel's tufted ears, white tummy, and fluffy tail inspired Beatrix Potter's The Tale of Squirrel Nutkin and provided the pattern for thousands of stuffed squirrel toys the world over. The red squirrel's history in Scotland has been filled with ups and downs, says Matthew Holmes. A historian of science at the University of Cambridge in England, Holmes has tracked the history of human opinion on animals such as squirrels and sparrows. At first, he explains, forests weren't primarily seen as habitat. People didn't view a forest as a place where things lived, unless they wanted to hunt those things. Instead, forests were trees, and trees were wood to be used in shipbuilding, fires, and more. But as people cut down the local forests, the things in them ran out of places to call home. The red squirrel, which spends most of its time in the trees, began to disappear. By the end of the 18th century, no fluffy red tails were to be seen in most of Scotland. The squirrel was saved in Scotland not by conservationists, but by aristocratic fashion. Around 1778, Elizabeth Scott, Duchess of Buccleuch, saw some red squirrels on her English lands and decided that she had to have them back in Scotland. She wasn't alone. Other aristocrats felt the same. The squirrels went well with the artfully disheveled deer parks they were building on their estates. The lords and ladies weren't necessarily inspired by a charitable sense of conservation. That idea didn't really exist yet. The aristocrats just liked the look of the landscaping and the money it could bring in from hunting tourism in their new parks. As rich people were more and more able to separate themselves from the worst the wild could send, it became much easier to appreciate its beauty. They brought back squirrels and their habitat in their new enthusiasm for nature. The animals took advantage, and the squirrel orgy began. They damaged local forests. They gobbled up bird eggs. This was a crime of the highest order to the Victorians, Holmes says, because if they took bird eggs, there were fewer left for the avid Victorian egg collector. Within a century, the red squirrel seemed doomed to a life of dodging gun-toting foresters and angry naturalists. Until the mid-20th century, red squirrels remained unpopular bird egg-munching villains. But as the century wore on, the Scots and the English saw their native red squirrel come under attack from the Americans. Not people, squirrels. Sciurus carolinensis, our eastern gray squirrel, was introduced from the Americas to English and Scottish woodlands in 1876. An army of Kevins quickly took over with a truly American sense of manifest destiny. The squirrel also carried squirrel pox, which gray squirrels can resist, but reds cannot. Fluffy red tails began once again to disappear. The former red squirrel pest became a cause for conservation concern. We used to hate the red squirrels, but now that they're outcompeted, we side with them, Holmes says. All kinds of weird nationalism and xenophobia comes in. Sure, the red squirrels were bad, but American squirrels were worse. They weren't Scottish or even from the United Kingdom. They probably chittered in bad accents. Now, the red squirrel is an icon in the British Isles. It graces teacups and mugs. There are breeding programs and protected areas. There are societies devoted to the squirrel's preservation. The red squirrel has joined the ranks of persecuted wild things. It's beloved. From unwanted to protected national symbol, pest is all about perspective. Much like buttercups and dandelions, they are weeds when bursting out of your expensive seeded lawn, but when gathered into a bouquet and handed to you by a grubby pair of 5-year-old hands, they are the most precious flowers in existence. Pest may seem like a bit of an offensive label for something as cute as a squirrel. It puts them in the same category as rats, mice, or pigeons. All of these are animals that aren't staying in what we've decided is their place. A squirrel in a tree is adorable. A squirrel in your garden or nesting in your roof is an annoyance, something that we should, at the least, control and, at the worst, eradicate. This means that the idea of a pest is very much in the eye of the beholder. I remember as an undergrad taking a course in sustainable agriculture, says Philip Nyhus, a professor of environmental studies at Colby College in Maine. The professor pointed out the terminology of pest and asked, "Why is this plant a pest, and this other one that looks just like it is not a pest?" Because somebody has decided that one plant is useful to eat or has some economic value, and the other one's essentially impinging on that. The impression the professor made was lasting. Nyhus is still fascinated by human conflict with animals. Some conservationists might say a pest disrupts a natural ecosystem. Not everyone would agree. English ivy, after all, lends gravitas to a facade but strangles native plants and rips bricks apart. An outdoor house cat is snuggly little Fluffy in the sheets and a murderer in the streets. Cats kill between 1 and 4 billion birds a year in the contiguous United States. But most cat owners get pretty upset if you start calling their beloved Fluffy a pest. The distinction between pest and not pest is entirely subjective. Nyhus has been able to pin it down a little. He has categorized human-wildlife conflict into 8 quadrants on a graph, which you can find in the enhancement. On the horizontal axis is how positive or negative an encounter with an animal, for the purposes of this book, or plant is. On the vertical axis is how intense that interaction could be. On the third axis, extending forward, out of the page, is how frequent an encounter with a species is. He can then put animal encounters into the 8 three-dimensional potential cubes of human judgment. For me, for example, snuggling a wombat on a trip to Australia would end up in the cube at the top back right. It's rare, very positive, has a high emotional impact, and is on my bucket list. On the bottom right, toward the front, you might have common but only slightly positive encounters.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.